Grab your Bible tonight and turn over to Acts chapter 7. Let me tell you right up front, I have no idea where this is going. It's amazing how your flesh never gets over after you trust God. Your flesh always goes, what? That's okay. I've just learned to ignore my flesh. In most areas. Except Kentucky Fried Chicken. How many? Demi, you know my weakness, though. Acts chapter 7. This is where Stephen had decided to step up and release what was in it. How many of you know you have the Almighty God of the universe living in you?
Right.
We're in this world, but we're not of it.
Amen.
You are a different creature. You're not just some old person that God's having favor with or favor on and mercy on. Well, you really don't deserve to come to heaven, but I'm going to let you anyway. He worked through his son and paid the highest price that could ever be paid, the most horrible price that could ever be paid, so that his nature, God's life and nature, could get back in you, come back into you. That blood sacrifice cleansed you so that he could come and dwell in you. That's why we're called the temple of the Holy Ghost. We're called the temple of God. God's nature is the Holy Spirit. Amen. The Holy Spirit is referred to as the glory of God. There's one scripture that says Jesus was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, and there's another scripture that says he was raised from the dead by the Holy Ghost. Holy Spirit, if you want to update it.
Right.
Tom Terry says he likes Holy Ghost because it sounds scary.
Yeah.
Tom Terry.
Sounds more lethal.
Sounds more lethal, yeah.
Yeah.
Scares the devil more, I guess. You know. But we have God's life and nature in us. We are definitely not of this world. When the Bible says you were born again, he means it. And really, that's kind of a real good term. That word actually means to be born from above.
Right.
Where it says, you know, you must be born again. Born from above. Or actually where Jesus told Nicodemus, he told him that you must be born again. You must be born from above. Of course, is it Nicodemus?
Yeah.
Is that right? No, Nicodemus. I thought I had the wrong name there for a minute. You know, he began to try to figure this whole thing out through natural birth. You mean I got to go back to my mother's womb and be born again? He says, no, that's not what I'm talking about. That which is born of the flesh, or in the natural realm, is natural. But that which is born of the spirit, everybody say spirit.
Spirit.
The spirit realm, the eternal realm. There's a part of you that is eternal. I mean, you're always eternal, even when you had sin nature. A spirit never dies, because a spirit lives in a realm that is not... doesn't have any time and all of that stuff. Doesn't have a beginning and end.
Right.
Amen? And so, you know, a spirit will always live. But once you get God's life in you, you live with him in you, filling every part of your being forever.
Yes. Yeah.
And that doesn't just happen when you die and leave your body. It's happening now.
Right. Yeah.
Probably the greatest tragedy on the earth is that the church... most of us have walked around most of our lives not even knowing who we are or how to be who we are and how to release what's in us to the people around us. That's what Jesus was all about. Everybody, you know, says, oh, well, Jesus was special. That was the only begotten Son of God. You're right. He was the only begotten Son of God. But if you study the scriptures, you find that in order for him to come down here and redeem us, he had to do it legally. He couldn't have a leg up on us.
Right.
That would have been illegal. The devil could have accused God of doing something illegal, and God actually, he would have become a liar and a manipulator and, you know, all of that. He would have become an unrighteous, unjust God.
Right.
So Jesus left all of his heavenly privileges as the glorified Son of God in heaven, and the Bible says he came down and he became a man. Now, he had God's nature in him. He's called the last Adam. Adam had God's nature in him, too, when he was created and put into this earth. But then, of course, Adam chose to sin. And when he chose to sin, God's nature left him because God's embrace would have destroyed him if God would have stayed with him and in him, because God consumed sin. And then Adam and Eve were left with that void. They were in darkness. They were left without the glory and nature of God in them. And you know the story how God sent Jesus, and he came. He stepped into Adam's shoes. He passed all the tests that Adam failed. And then he willingly gave himself to go through the torturous experience of being separated from God and having all the results of sin, every sin that would ever happen in time on this earth, come on him. Amen. He paid that price. Why? So when he rose from the dead, he could give us his spirit. He could pour his spirit out upon us. He could cause his spirit to live and abide in us. And so we have the glory. We are containers of the glory of God.
Yes.
Put your hand on your stomach and say, in me abides the glory of God. God dwells in me. And God wants to get out.
Amen.
Amen. Like a genie wanting to get out of a bottle, God wants to get out of you into this earth. And that's what Jesus did. See, Jesus had to be anointed by the Spirit of God. The Bible says when he was baptized in water and he came up out of the water, the Holy Spirit came upon him, empowering him, anointing him. And then he was led by the Spirit into the wilderness, faced the devil, passed the tests, got victory, came out of the wilderness in the power of the Spirit. And then he began to go around this earth by the Spirit's leading.
Yes.
As the Father gave direction from heaven through the Holy Spirit, he began to go around this earth just letting God out of him. Letting glory out of him.
Amen.
He glorified God in word and deed. At the end of his life on this earth, over in John 17, as he prayed that great high priestly prayer, he said, Father, I have glorified you on this earth.
Yes.
I have glorified you. Your glory operated in my life. Hallelujah.
That's good.
And there was a young man here by the name of Stephen who understood this. He's one of the early church folks that God used him because he yielded to God. Notice what it says here, and let's go back to chapter 6, verse 8. Chapter 6, verse 8. And Stephen, full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Now, what does anybody know what ministry Stephen had in the church, within the church body?
Servant.
Servant. He was a deacon. He was a table waiter. They were having strife in the church. Believe it or not, they had strife in the church back in those days, too. And so the apostles said, find some men, find some people that are people of character, people that can be trusted, because they were having this dispute because they were feeding the Grecian and Hebrew widows. And there was this accusation, well, that group's getting more than we're getting. Sound familiar, doesn't it? And so they handled that by, and it's here in chapter 6. Let's just go ahead and read it, since we don't know where this is going tonight. Verse 1, in those days, when the number of the disciples were multiplied, and there arose a murmuring of the Grecians against the Hebrews because their widows were neglected in the daily ministration. Then the 12 called the multitude of disciples unto them and said, it is not reason that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Wherefore, brethren, look ye out among you, 7 men of honest report, full of the Holy Ghost. Notice the requirements here. The requirement for serving people in the church. People outside of the church.
Right.
Honest report, full of the Holy Ghost.
Right.
And wisdom.
Yes. Yeah.
Whom you may appoint over this business. Excuse me. Verse 4. But we will give ourselves continually to prayer and the ministry of the word. Now, the apostles weren't lazy. They weren't, you know, unwilling to serve tables. But they understood their part.
Right.
They understood that if they will do what God's called them to do, it will strengthen the body so people can do what God's called them to do.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yes.
God didn't call us to be the jack of all trades.
Right.
Because if we do that, we'll be master of none.
Yes.
That's right.
We need to find what God's saying to us. And if God's told you to wait tables, if God's told you to sweep floors, if God's told you to do whatever, the anointing of God's going to be on it. It's going to be a blessing, and you will get credit and a reward in heaven for your faithful service to the Lord. I could really run off on an old rabbit trail right there, but I'm not going to. Let's stay with this tonight. Praise God. And so it says the same, verse 5, pleased the whole multitude. They chose Stephen, and he gives the names of the rest of them there. I can't pronounce them, so I'm not going to read them. Most of them anyway. Verse 6, whom they set over the apostles, set before the apostles, and when they had prayed, they laid their hands on them. Now notice they laid their hands on them. What were they doing? They were imparting the anointing to these men to serve widows and orphans food. Hallelujah. Well, I just thought the preacher was the only anointed one. No. You've got, it says we want people full of the Holy Ghost.
Yeah.
Because the Holy Ghost is going to help them do this. And it's going to be a greater blessing than just somebody getting a Big Mac or something. Lunch. Amen? Yeah. And verse 7, and the word of God, notice the results of people serving tables under the anointing of God. The word of God increased, and the number of disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great company of the priests were obedient to the faith. Isn't it amazing how some little something that you would think, oh, just a little church, you know, snafu here, and, you know, oh, my part's not much, you know, I just do this, and I just do that. Listen, it all comes together, it all works together, it all means something more. The enemy is always trying to bring strife, or he's trying to somehow bring discord, or he's trying to get us to think we can do things our way and ask God to bless our plan. God don't need your plan. He's not going to bless your plan. What he wants you to do is come to him and say, Lord, what is your plan for my life? What do you want me to do right now? And when you listen to him, he's going to show you the next step. And if you'll take that next step in that plan, whether you think it's right or not, or you want to do it or not, if you'll do it faithfully and do it as unto the Lord, then his blessing will come on you, and he'll take care of you, he'll promote you, he'll take you forward in your life, and he'll take you into what he has for you in this world.
Amen.
Praise God. Amen?
Yes, yes.
Glory to God. So it says in verse 8, Stephen was full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. Where did he do it? Up on the platform, on the stage, in the lights?
No,
at the tables. At the tables. He just believed God would use him to supernaturally serve food and to minister to people as he was doing it. He might have been giving somebody a bowl of food. The Lord said that person, you know, is suffering from depression. And so he just, are you struggling with depression? Yes. Let me pray for you.
Amen.
Boom. The glory that was in it.
Glory.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah. Now see, we've got to develop a servant's heart.
Yes.
We got to get over ourselves.
Right.
Get over yourself.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, people hurt me and this and that. This and that. We've all been hurt.
Yeah. Yeah.
We've all been mistreated. After Adam and Eve sinned, there were no families that were, you know, functional families. Every family's been dysfunctional ever since that time.
Yeah.
Amen. Remember that story about the two guys? I think they were in New York. One of them was a CEO, millionaire guy, doing well in life financially and all this. And the other guy was his twin brother, I think it was. He was on the streets, living in a cardboard box, on drugs and all messed up, just barely alive. And this reporter found out about it, that they were brothers, and went and interviewed them, and to find out how they ended up that way, how come that one of them, you know, was this successful person in life, the other one wasn't. And both of them, when he went to them, went to the guy, you know, in the cardboard box, and he says, how come you're living? He goes, it was my father. My father treated me bad, and da-da-da-da-da-da, and he was an alcoholic, and da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Then he went to the other brother and says, how come you're so successful? He goes, it was my father. He was an alcoholic. He was a horrible example. And I determined in my life I'm not going to be that way. See, we can't blame. I mean, what happened, happened, and it did affect you. And you do deal with things. Amen? But the devil's line and his trap in this is to get you to swim around in that cesspool of memories and blaming things. Maybe they did do that, but listen, they're not God and they're not bigger than God. And if you will give that thing to the Lord and you'll give yourself to Him and you'll get focused on Him, and instead of focusing on what happened to me or how I even feel about it, start focusing on God. How can I be a blessing?
Amen.
Yes.
Being blessed is, there's no big super duper Holy Ghost secret to it. The Bible says the cardinal rule of the kingdom of God is this: whatsoever a person plants or sows, that is what they're going to reap.
Yes.
So if I live my life, I get up out of bed every morning, Lord, how can I, you know, make you smile? How can I bless you?
Thank you, Jesus.
How can I give you joy? How can I bless people and give them joy and help them? You know, if they're in a struggle or whatever, help them come out. How can I, you know, help them financially or help them, pray for them, or just, you know, maybe just give them an encouraging word.
Yes.
You start living your life from that perspective, you're not going to have any more depressed days. Oh, you'll have depression come at you again. You'll have things happen that'll take you off for a while. You'll want to strangle somebody or whatever. Come on. Don't give me the sanctimonious look. Our flesh is that way. Right? But if you focus on these things, if you just start looking at all that's not fixed yet or all that you think is wrong, you know, some things you think are wrong are not wrong. They're in process. They're in process. I found out in my life, as I ran for my call for 16 years, that God had to let me just go down to a point to where I went, my God, I don't want to go another step this direction. It wasn't Him that said, I'm just going to ignore Him for 16 years and let Him. No. He was talking to me all the time in here. And I was making all these lame excuses that people make. I was blaming my problems on my wife or somebody else, or, you know, they didn't potty train me right, or whatever it is that people come up with nowadays. And there again, I'm not saying that things don't affect you, but God is God. You're serving God. You have God in you. God will take you up out of that, and He'll even build on that. He'll give you a compassion for people who've gone through what you've gone through, and He'll start sending you to them.
Yes, that's true.
That's right. Amen. One thing I found is that in an area, whatever area I'm hurting in, if I'll start finding people that are hurting in the same areas and start ministering to them, start sowing into them, I find that I'm going to reap.
Hallelujah.
Help in that area.
Amen.
Yeah. I remember Larry was talking about, he was preaching some big meeting and his back was so messed up he couldn't hardly walk. He said it was like this. You know, just walked up the pulpit, you know, hi, how are you? Praise the Lord. You know. And he preached for a while and he said, I don't know how to deal with this. He said, how many of you in this congregation are having back trouble? Huh. You know, it was a big church or a big congregation, so a lot of people responded. They came and lined up. He said he went down at the end of this line and started praying for him. And he said he was still hurting as bad as he was hurt. He said the further he got down the line, the looser his back got. All of a sudden, pain started to leave. And before you know it, he said, he was, glory to God. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
See, we can't let the devil keep us in that circle of chasing our tail.
Amen.
Praise God.
Yes.
Stephen just decided that he was going to be the most anointed, Holy Ghost, miracle-working, power table waiter there was.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Praise God. Yeah, it's all important. It's all important. We are members of the body of Christ. We're members one of another.
Amen.
You have no idea that thing you may think is insignificant, little, not important. You have no idea what that key that might be.
Exactly.
You know, if you're working in the nursery, you're working in the toddlers or in the children, and you're keeping somebody's kids otherwise their parents would be distracted or even leave church halfway through and not hear what God wanted them to hear that day and receive the anointing. You may be the key of somebody living instead of dying of cancer because you put up with a bunch of little snotty-nosed kids running in a circle.
Because
you were anointed.
Yeah.
That's
right.
To do it.
That's right.
Hallelujah. I know you've heard this before, but sometimes we need to hear it again. Amen. Praise God. So Stephen was a man full of faith and power, did great wonders and miracles among the people. And of course, you know, you start operating in God, the devil doesn't like him, so all the religious folks are going to get up in the air about it. And they brought in these people that falsely accused him of things and, you know, and all this kind of thing. And so chapter 7, verse 1, it says, "Then said the high priest, are these things so? And he said, Men, brethren, and fathers, hearken, or listen. The God of glory appeared unto our father Abraham when he was in Mesopotamia before he dwelt in Haran." The God of glory. Everybody say the God of glory. Notice how Stephen identified with God. He saw him as the God of glory.
Yeah.
Now what does the word glory mean? Well, the word glory means, it means all that God is and all that he does. You know, a king sitting on a throne, owning land and a castle or whatever, it's his glory. It's all that he has, all that he is, all that his authority and all that kind of thing. The God of glory. See, Stephen didn't get up and say, "Wait a minute, you guys are picking on me. You've hurt my feelings. I'm offended."
Right.
He began to talk about the God of glory. Now, I know they stoned him to death here, and he was a martyr. And he was put to death. But you know, not long after this, the guy that was behind this named Saul ended up flat on his face on the road to Damascus with the glory of God so bright in his eyes. He was blinded for a few days and ended up being called into and shifting into a ministry that causes you and I to know the in Christ truth and what it's all about in our day and hour.
Right. Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. The God of glory. We are the glorious church.
Yes.
We have the glory in us.
Yes.
We've been made for glory. We were never made to be without God's presence, without his glory.
Amen.
That's why people are always searching for more, something else. They can never come to that place of total peace and satisfaction because they were designed to live in the peace and the satisfaction of the presence of Almighty God.
Come on, hallelujah.
Yielded to him, allowing him to work through their words, to work through their thoughts, to work through their hands and their feet, just to honor and glorify him.
Thank you, Father.
The Bible says that you and I are a letter, that we are a letter read of men.
Yeah.
You know, I've had some of the kids from Michael's group when he was growing up. You know, now they're 40-year-old men. People that he played ball with and different things. I've had them come up to me in these days and say, "You know, you have no idea how much of an example and blessing you were to me." Some of them I probably never said hardly 10 words to. Now, I'm not bragging on me. I want you to understand what I'm saying here. We don't realize what shines out of us.
Amen.
We don't realize how we affect an atmosphere. We affect atmospheres.
Right.
Amen.
Amen. But we need to keep our focus on being a blessing. Not being a rug for somebody to walk on. Not just wearing yourself out. Amen.
Amen.
But at the same time, living your life to be a blessing.
Right.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
When people curse you with their words, what does Jesus say to do?
Bless them.
Why? Because it says we're contrary-wise, we're to bless them instead of curse them, knowing that we are to receive a blessing.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yes.
Glory to God.
Lord.
See, you're so blessed, the devil can't do anything about it.
Amen.
You are.
Amen.
You're so blessed, the devil doesn't have one hope in heaven or hell to stop you.
That's right.
So what does he do? He convinces you to do it.
That's right.
Yeah, lies.
He wants you to open your mouth and open your heart and let your motives become wrong and your words become wrong so that he can legally come in and bring a curse into your life.
Good word. It's true. That's it.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And so we just have to make up our minds. I'm going to be a blessing.
Yes. Yeah.
I don't care if they don't like me. I'm going to bless them anyway.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
I'm going to bless them.
Amen.
See, Jesus said, if you'll do this, you'll pray for those that despitefully use you and people that are dead. He says it's like pouring coals of fire on their head. Now, some people get excited about that. Oh, yeah, let's just snuff them out and burn them up, baby. Crispy critters, let's do it right here. Get revenge. That's not what he's talking about. The fire of God consumes the things that aren't of God. And when the fire of God comes on a person's life, you talk about somebody squirming. You talk about somebody miserable. You talk about somebody that ends up running to the altar and getting saved. Hallelujah.
Yeah.
See, when there's manifestations of the fire of God in the earth, look at the classic example is Acts chapter 2. 120 people in a prayer meeting, they're praying and interceding. All of a sudden, the fire of God shows up.
Yes.
The Holy Ghost shows up.
Great.
Amen?
Amen.
Yes.
And what happened? 3,000 people said, what must we do?
Yeah.
What do? We got to do something here. We got to have this. John G. Lake, a great man of God, God used in South Africa, and he was an apostle of faith. He lived in Washington, and the city he lived in Washington at one point was actually declared by the government the healthiest city in America, and it was because of his healing ministry. He had such a strong healing ministry. And one time he was out for a walk late at night in a park, and there was just something in his heart. He knew there was more of God, or he needed something more from God. And he said that he was walking, he had his Bible in his hand, and he said an angel literally appeared to him. Which is not, you know, outside of the realm of God's dealings with men. There's people in this room that have seen angels. And this angel walked up to him and reached out and took his Bible out of his hand and turned to Acts chapter 2. He said, teach people to seek this. He said, this is the only thing that will satisfy the human heart. When they get baptized in the Holy Ghost, and the life and the love of God is flowing forth in them, and the flames of God's purifying fire is blessing their life. Teach them to seek this, because he said, once they step into this, once the Holy Spirit is in them, and they're filled with his purpose and his passion and his power, then that's what's going to satisfy. He said, that and that alone will satisfy the human heart.
Yeah.
Thank you, Father.
I believe in the blessing of the Lord.
Oh, yeah.
I believe in God blessing you financially. I believe in him blessing your body. I believe in him giving you wisdom. I believe in him watching over your children and covering you and protecting you. I believe in all that.
Yeah.
But I'm going to tell you right now, having God's fire, having his nature, having that close, Mike was talking about it this morning, stepping into that place of fellowship with him, believing that he's in you, believing that if you'll seek him, you'll find him, believing if you'll just step over and start talking to him like he's there, you'll find out he is.
Yes. Yes.
He says in the word, I'll never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. Amen. I have forsook him more than once in my life. But he's never forsaken me.
Right.
When I got done with my little whatever I was doing and turned around, he was right there.
Yeah.
He didn't run off and hide. Hallelujah. Praise God. He's the God of glory.
Amen.
And he lives in me. He lives in me. Now, I just feel like I'm supposed to shift gears here a little bit. We're in a time, a fullness of time. I don't have time to go into all the details. We've talked about some of this before, but we're at a time where God is shifting everything in the earth. He's shifting things. He's shifting governments. Look at how many heads of governments over the last several years have toppled. Egypt, Libya, other places. God's shifting things. He's lining things up for this last end time move of God.
Come on.
Yes.
And he's also shifting the church.
Yes, he is.
And notice what Hannah said earlier about pruning. That's what God's doing.
Yes.
See, we have things in us that may make sense to our mind, or they may not make any sense at all to us. or we may not even know they're there. You know, in the story of, or in the parable of the wheat and the tares, Jesus said, of course, the wheat is symbolic of God's planting and His goodness in our life. But then it says, while men slept, have you ever been spiritually asleep?
Yes, I have.
I was spiritually asleep for years. I was a born-again child of God, had the life of nature and God, of God inside of me, but I went to sleep spiritually. I wasn't watching and praying like Jesus told me to. And so as a result, just like those disciples there at Gethsemane, that He told them to pray with Him for an hour, and they fell asleep, He said, watch and pray, or when the temptation comes, you're going to fall into the temptation. And that's exactly what happened to me, because I went to sleep.
Right.
Come on.
Amen.
So, being asleep, it says in that parable of the wheat and the tares, it says, while men slept, an enemy came in and planted some other stuff among the wheat. And they're called tares. They're actually a false wheat. And you actually can't tell that they're a false wheat until it's harvest time. I'm going to tell you right now, folks, we are in harvest time. Now, I know it's been harvest time in a general sense, you know, from Pentecost and all that, but we are in a major harvest time beginning. You're going to see it start this year. You're going to see things begin to increase in that area. You're going to see people get saved. You're going to see rebellious people that know God, that are asleep spiritually, try to find a place to get saved or restored to God. That's coming. It's coming. Amen. And that parable of the wheat and the tares, it was harvest time. The Bible says in the story there that during the season of harvest was when the angels would come in and they would take out the things out of God's kingdom and burn them.
Glory.
The things that offend God's kingdom. Where is God's kingdom? In us. Jesus said the kingdom of God does not come with observation out here. It's in you. So God's coming to us in our lives. And He's saying, look here where the devil planted a tare in John Pursell. This thing's growing up. He thinks it's wheat, but it's nothing but an old darnel, stiff piece of fake wheat. I'm ripping that out of here.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to get rid of that thing.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
You know, the fake wheat, they say one way they can tell it's fake or it's not the real thing is that when the wind blows across the wheat and the wheat, you know, you've seen on TV how the wheat will do this. Well, that fake stuff is stiff and hard and won't flow or move with the wind. People that have got a lot of darnel or fake wheat and then tares in them, when the Holy Ghost wind starts blowing, they do this.
That's good.
Yeah.
When God starts blowing His voice on their life, when He starts speaking to them, when He starts coming to them, and maybe bringing conviction, saying, you need to give your life back to me and let me have your life.
Right.
Or He comes to them and begins to convict them of their attitudes or whatever. If they don't have the right kind of thing in their heart, they're going to just stiffen up. Ooh, you don't want to be that.
No.
I don't want no angel ripping me out and casting me in the fire.
Stiff neck.
I want to go with the flow as when God does flow.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. But see, we're in a time like that. God is coming for our own good.
Yeah.
For my own good. He's taking the things out of me that are going to keep me from being able to function fully in the season that I'm stepping into. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
It's true, folks. I'm telling you. It's true. Just let Him do it. Just open your heart. Just be like David. Lord, if there's anything in me that needs to go, I want it out. And the first thing that will happen usually is you'll begin to see it for what it is. And the devil will try to use that to condemn you. Well, you're not a Christian. Well, you this. Well, you that. Look at that attitude you have. And da-da-da-da-da. No. God is showing you that this thing's in here. Don't let the devil interpret what's going on for you. You go to God and say, Lord, I didn't even know that was in me. Or maybe there are some things. You know, Lord, this keeps growing in my life and manifesting in my life. And I don't know how to deal with it. Just go to Him and He's going to work and do what He has to do to bring that out. And don't try to tell Him how to do it. Don't try to figure out how he's going to do it. Just listen to him, meet with him, and he'll lead you into a place. And one day you'll wake up and that thing will be gone from your life.
Amen.
And it won't hurt.
Amen. You put a little Holy Ghost anesthesia on you to deal with it. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God.
Thank you, Lord.
I don't want anything in me that's not of God.
Amen.
I don't want any heart motive in John Pursell that's
yes.
not of God.
Amen.
I don't want to walk around with a bunch of religious foolishness in my head
yes. right.
and not be God.
Right.
Right.
Now another secret to this and key to this is humility.
Yes.
Living in humility.
Yes.
Humility is not beating yourself up. I don't deserve it. That's false humility.
Right.
You're actually embarrassing. Well, no, I won't use that word. You're actually speaking against what God's done. God's made you the righteousness of God. He's made you in right standing with Him. You're His child. You've been blessed, the Bible says, with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. God sees you in Christ. He sees you through the blood. He sees you purified and perfected by His Son.
Right.
So humility is just simply understanding that God has done this for me, and for me to walk in this, and especially walking out on this earth, I need to have Him show me how to do that.
Yes. Yeah,
so yeah. I come to You, Lord, humbly before You, bowing before You, asking You to give me Your wisdom, asking You to work in me. I present myself for Your benefit, for Your glory, whatever is going to bless You and bless other people in this world. That's what I'm about, Father.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
And when you live that way on a daily basis, He can bring you into the fullness of blessings. The Bible says that Jesus knew that He was equal with God. But it says He humbled Himself. He humbled Himself, took on a body of a human, and humbled Himself. And it says that because He did that, He was given a name that was above every name. Humility puts you in a position for God to lift you up and give you a position of authority, give you a fullness. See, we all have that intrinsic knowing inside us that there's a place in His kingdom that He has for me. He wants to promote me into something powerful, something great, something good, something effective. But the way to that place is in humility.
Yes.
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 Amen. Thank You, Lord.
Amen.
Yeah.
You know, I knew I was called into the ministry. The Lord showed me that when I was a teenager. Because the Bible says He shows us the end from the beginning. Just like with Joseph, He showed Joseph in two dreams, you're going to be a man of authority, and people of authority are going to bow down to you. That was the beginning of his life. God showed him that that was going to be the end, or what was going to be the outcome or the purpose. He showed it to him from the beginning. So God will do that. I knew that I was called to that, but I wasn't humbling myself before the Lord and letting Him give me the pathway. And so in 1979, I prayed that prayer in my truck, in my work truck, and I really made a sincere, total, absolute sellout commitment to God. I gave Him my life, lock, stock, and barrel, 110%, if that's possible.
Yeah.
I didn't promise I was never going to sin again, but I promised Him He had my life, and I would let Him be Lord in my life.
Yeah.
And the first thing, you know, He didn't tell me, that, okay, well, I've called you to preach, so go get a microphone and start preaching tomorrow.
Right.
No more than He told Joseph to go and apply for the prime minister position in Egypt the next day.
Right.
But what He said was, I want you to go to this church, and He said, I want you to serve this pastor and this church.
Yeah.
However you can.
Yeah.
Didn't even mention preaching. Didn't even mention pastor. Didn't even mention leading a ministry.
Right.
Why? Because He had to make sure that I understood that the only way even leadership or a power position, or whatever you want to call it, a position of promotion, that only way that's going to work long term is if my submission is to Him.
Yeah.
And I live in a humble attitude toward Him so that He can do that through me. Otherwise, I get into some kind of power trip, start trying to do it for Him.
Yeah.
And the enemy comes in and brings the whole thing crashing down. Hallelujah. The Lord is good. Praise God. So I just stayed before him. See, I'm 65 years old. I know that I'm at a place right now where the fullness of what God's called me to do is going to begin to be manifest in my life.
Right.
You know, a lot of people retire around that time. And that's okay if that's what you need to do or what the Lord even leads you to do. But it ought to be the most fruitful time of your life, of any of the phases of your life. Because you've lived your life planting seed, watering plants, you know, being a blessing, and now God wants to bless your life. That's why Moses, at 80 years old, God comes to him and says, okay, now it's time. All this stuff that you've gone through, this learning, you've learned how to you know, do what you need to do in Egypt. You've learned how to be a shepherd and be humble before me. You've learned these lessons that I've taught you. And I'm sure Moses prayed many prayers out on those hillsides while he was watching over those sheep. God came to him finally and he says, okay, now it's time for you to reap all that you've planted for all these years, to step into a position of authority, and you're going to see the manifestation and the demonstration of all that you've sown in your life before. Now, I'm not saying to people in here that are, you know, in their 20s or their 30s, 40s, or even 50s, I'm not saying that you're not going to have a harvest right now. But what I am saying is that with God, these things increase, they don't decrease.
Yeah.
It's like the Lord spoke to me here a while back, and he said, John, you can be an older or you can be an elder. It's up to you. Some people decide to be an older. Well, I'm getting old. You know, I'm just going to quit and go hide from people. Or whatever. Better check with God. Amen. I believe, and it's just I'm just sharing this with you. I believe through my life in yielding to God, I'm going to see more done for the rest of my life, from now to the rest of my life, than I saw from the time I was born up to this day.
Amen.
Glory to God.
I agree.
Yes.
Now, there'll be a lot of other people involved in all of that. Amen.
Amen.
Moses found out he couldn't do it all.
Right.
He tried and was driving himself nuts. He had to yield to the Lord and let the Lord do it the way he needed to do it.
Yes.
But the glory of God in our lives, see, that's all part of the glory too, isn't it?
Yes.
It should increase, not decrease.
Yeah.
Now you will go through times where it's times where God just pulls you aside. There's not a lot of demonstration and manifestation in your life where it's just kind of you and him. He'll pull you aside like he did Jesus so that he can talk to you. You know, the devil... But when Jesus was in the wilderness there before he went into his ministry, he wasn't in the desert or the wilderness sitting there looking for the devil. When's the devil going to show up? He was fellowshipping with his Father.
Yes.
You know why? Because he knew the devil was going to show up.
Right.
And he knew that he needed to hear from his Father about what he was going to go into in this next phase.
Yes.
It's like what Mike was preaching this morning. If you'll spend some time with God, he'll start talking to you. He'll start ministering to you. He'll talk to you about things that in your mind don't even make sense to connect with what you think your problems are. But he knows the root of those things, and he's going to deal with them.
Right. Yes.
And Jesus was having such a time with his Father in the wilderness that when the devil did show up and say, you know, you haven't ate anything in over 40 days, I bet you're really hungry. Matter of fact, you're really hungry right now. And if you really are the Son of God, turn those stones into bread. And Jesus didn't have to stop and pray about it. You know why? Because he'd already been praying about it. He was already with his Father. And out of him came an immediate answer from the Holy Ghost out of him. Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. I've been listening to my Father talk, and he knows I'm hungry. He knows my needs. He's going to take care of me. I'm not going to let you devils start leading me. I'm going to fellowship with my Father. And see, God was able to defeat the enemy at every turn. And then out of that, he was launched into a place of authority in the Spirit, where he was able to go out and demonstrate the glory of God.
Right.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Yeah.
Praise God.
That's right.
Separate time with God is so valuable.
Yes, it is.
It's so important.
Yes.
It's not going in there trying to get something. Oh, God, I want to get something.
Right.
It's going in there being something. It's being before Him. I myself, personally, I like to close my eyes and meditate on Hebrews chapter 12, where it says, "You are come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, to an innumerable company of angels, and to the general assembly and church of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, to the spirits of just mankind made perfect, and to Jesus, the great high priest mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaks better things than that of Abel." I like to see myself right there in the throne room. You know why? Because I am. My spirit's right there. God said in Hebrews 4, "Come boldly into the throne." If He wouldn't have let me come in, or I couldn't get in, why would He invite me in? Amen? There again, it's one of those spiritual things. We have to separate the natural realm from the spirit. I can close my eyes and see the throne room of God inside me. See, God wants you to have a sanctified imagination. Do you ever notice how powerful your imagination is? Your imagination is so powerful, you can start thinking thoughts about hating somebody, and if you just chew on that long enough in your imagination, that thing will turn into a heart motive of murder. Maybe you wouldn't go out and necessarily murder him yourself, but you'd wish him dead. God wants to sanctify your imagination. He wants you to understand that there's an element of the Spirit that you can step into, a place you can step into where you're beholding Him. You're beholding Him. See, I'm beholding Him right now. I can see Him on the inside of me. It's not just John Pursell daydreaming.
Right.
It's not even day. How can I daydream? It's understanding that the spirit realm is more real than the natural realm.
Yeah, it is.
It's understanding that God is speaking to you. He's revealing Himself to you. As you glorify Him, the Bible says, as we look into the face of Jesus, we become like Jesus.
Yes.
This thing doesn't happen from the inside out. It happens from the outside, or the in, from the outside in. It happens from the inside out.
Yeah.
What's in us comes out of us.
Yes.
And what's in you?
Amen.
Eternity.
Hallelujah.
Eternity.
Lord.
The whole kingdom. The Bible says, see some of these statements that Paul wrote. Paul, he spent a couple of years praying in the Holy Ghost, seeking God. His whole, you talk about somebody's life getting turned upside down. One minute he's a PhD in the law, understood. He studied under Gamaliel, who was the great PhD, you know, rabbi of his day. He understood what it meant to, about the Mosaic law. He understood all that stuff. And God in one day just flipped him upside down and introduced him to Jesus. He had to go out in the wilderness and figure this thing out.
Yeah. Yes, amen.
So he went out and got with God and prayed in the Spirit. And the revelatory work of God began to work in him. And God, I can just see it now. I know it happened because you can read it in his writings. God started reaching over in the Old Testament to pull the scripture out and said, "See this, Paul? This is what this really means."
Praise God.
It was in that old covenant, that covenant I planted, that seed I planted through Abraham, and began to grow the stem and began to grow the branches. But the fruition of it is in the Spirit. The fullness of it is over here in the New Testament.
Yeah.
I was growing that thing into something all the time.
Amen.
And here's what that meant. Here's what it means to you today. Hallelujah.
Yeah. Thank you, Lord.
And so we just, as we step over into that place, as we worship God, as we pray in other tongues, I'm telling you, we don't pray, at least I'll say me, I don't pray in the Spirit as much as I need to. And there again, it's not about, I spend an hour praying in tongues, so God's going to reward me. It's about me going somewhere. It's about me letting go of John Purcell's limited intellect. His limited ability to know where he's at, where he needs to go with God. And stepping over into a place where I yield to the Holy Ghost, who searches all things, yea, the deep things of God. He searches out the mysteries. He knows my future better than I know my past. And he'll use my own mouth to pray out before the Father in heaven, which causes a release of angels, which causes a release of provision, which causes a release of wisdom. To where I begin to walk in the understanding and the wisdom of God. And all of a sudden, one day, it dawns on me.
Yeah.
who I am and what I'm supposed to do. It comes by revelation. That problem I've been wondering about for years, the answer comes and it dawns on you. It begins to happen because the Holy Ghost has worked through you to pray these things out. Your future, praying out your future.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We're temples of His glory. We're temples of His glory. Hallelujah. As we look at the problems of life, we look at the institutions of life, the situations of life, we need to approach them from the Spirit. We need to approach them from the Spirit. We need to pray. If God's quickened you to about the school system or about political things or about whatever, if it's in your heart, don't just debate that in your own mind. Don't argue with people about it. Get over in the Holy Ghost and begin to pray about that. Lord, this thing is in me. You've put this in me, this concern for this area or these people, or there's this motivation about this. And so, Father, I bring it before you, and I'm going to pray in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to yield to the Holy Ghost. I'm going to let Him help me by leading me in prayer. And I'm going to step into that interpretation of tongues if that's the way it comes forth, or a dream or a vision or whatever. And I'm going to step into that greater realm, that greater place of glory.
Yes.
Yeah.
See, that's what it's all about.
Yes.
A stepping up into something. People are waiting for a Holy Ghost move of God where a glory bomb is going to hit the earth. They are. They are. Oh God, come down here. Come down here. Come down here. You know what He says in Hebrews? Come up here. You come up here, and when you go back down there, I'll be with you down there. It'll happen. It'll happen. It'll happen. When Moses went up the mountain, he came back down with shafts of light on his face. He came back down with the wisdom of God in his mouth. He came back down with the Torah. The Torah that God used, praise God, to govern His people. To help His people through the sacrificial system to bless that nation if they would obey Him and stay with it and walk with Him. But it didn't come because Moses was down there with the people on the land saying, come down here, Lord. God says, I'm going to come down as close as I can without killing you. I'm going to come down on a mountain. And then I want you to come up here. God still lives on the mountain. Hebrews 12, Mount Zion, the city of the living God. You know, I'm convinced that we ought to be so familiar with heaven that when we actually go there, it'll be like getting home instead of going to a new place. We won't have to have the angelic tour bus take us around. I mean, I'm sure there'll be things we won't know about, of course.
Sure, sure.
But I believe the atmosphere of heaven,
that's good.
We should be so used to it because we're walking with God in it here on earth.
Yes.
I've been in rooms where saints were dying. People that knew God. They weren't just in the family and heard about God like a distant relative. They knew Him. They walked with Him. They talked with Him. And there's a different atmosphere in that kind of a room than there is in other places.
Yeah. Right.
It's hard to explain, and some of you have probably been there too. But there's just this atmosphere, this heavenly place. This heavenly atmosphere, I guess, is the best way to say it. God's wanting us to live in heaven while we're on earth. That's why Jesus said, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. I praise You, Father. Thank You for the greater glory, Lord. For you see, I'm calling you, says the Lord, to step up. To stand up and to step up. To step up into that place. To begin to believe the things you've heard. To begin to believe the things that you know inside your own heart. To not try to figure out everything with your mind or understand it all. But just answer the Holy Spirit call. Just step over the line. step into that place. Begin to worship me from your spirit in truth, full of grace. And you'll find there'll be a place that you will abide in me. You'll find there'll be a place where I'll open your eyes and they'll see. You'll find there'll be a place where the glory shall encompass you round about. You'll find it, says the Lord. You'll find it. So step over into that place by faith this day and learn to walk in my Holy Spirit way. And the things of this earth will not weigh you down like before, because you'll know what to do. You'll know what to say. You'll know what to be, and you'll know how to pray. And the enemy will come and be defeated every time. As you abide in me, he knows not to cross that line. He'll not come to touch you and to harass you as before, because you will be in me, and you will have learned so much more. Yes, I'm calling people to step up and stand up here in this time. I'm calling them to step out into the earth and to draw those bloodlines. I'm calling you to be a David. I'm calling you to be that one. That one of courage who knows their own covenant with Jesus Christ the Son. Will you be one of those? Will you stand up today? Will you be one of those who will begin to seek me and pray? Will you be one of those who lives out of that place that's in you? Or will you be one of those who'll run around in the darkness and not know what to do? For you see, we've come to it. It's here and it's now today. The people are going to have to decide. Are they going to play or are they going to pray? And as you pray, as you step in with me, you'll come to a place that you never thought you would see. A place of my glory, a place of my wisdom too. Much shall be revealed and shown unto you.
Yes.
And as you simply walk it out, as you let it flow like a river from within, the blessings of the Lord will come, and many people will be delivered from sin, because they'll get in the river. They'll see the refreshing that it brings to their life. They'll say, I want in on that. I'm tired of all this demonic strife. I'm going to move into peace. I'm going to move into that place. I'm going to step on into the river of grace. Yes, that's where I want to be. I want to go with you. And you'll say, come on, take my arm, my hand, and we'll go, we too. Hallelujah. We'll do what he's called us to do. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory to God. There's a mantle of wisdom that's right there waiting for you to pick it up and put it on. There's a mantle of revelation. There's a place of enlightenment, a place of understanding, where God is going to reveal the hidden secrets. Things hidden from the beginning. He's going to reveal them to you as you step into that place. And as you begin to seek him, as you begin to worship him, you're going to see it. You're going to know it. You're going to act on it. And the results are going to be forthcoming in Jesus' name. We love you, Father. Just praise him for a minute. Just worship him. Just worship him. Get your eyes on him. Get your attitude toward him of honor and worship and praise. Yes, there are some things in people's lives in this place tonight. I would have led you out of that place long ago, but you didn't pick up what I was saying. You didn't know. And so I'm saying to you tonight, come on back in. Come on and worship me. Be with me. Stand in that place where we can be together. And find out that your soul will not be weighted any longer, but you'll be as light as a feather. Come into that place, says the Lord. And I'll lead you out of some things that the enemy has been able to do. I'll cause you to walk on that pathway. And you'll be a blessing. Just me and you. Walk with me. Talk with me. Let me say what I need to say. And you'll be blessed, says the Lord, as you walk in that Holy Spirit way. For that's what's going to cause success and blessing in this life. Not trying to know it all and force your way in through the enemy's strife, but stepping up and standing up and knowing who I am in you, walking in that place where you have my wisdom and you know what to do. Hallelujah.
Yes, that's right. Thank you, Lord.
Yes. He doesn't want you to waste another day worrying, trying to figure it out, trying to make it happen, trying to please him so much that he'll finally promote you. That's not what it's about. He already wants to promote you. He already wants to bless you. He already wants to do some things. He's just saying if you'll come and be with him, you'll be able to flow with him so they'll get done. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. No loose ends. No loose ends. Everything tied up like it's supposed to be. Thank you, Father. I praise you. Oh, Son of God. Lord, I thank you for that explosion of light. I thank you for that explosion of revelation. I thank you for dreams and for visions. I thank you for dreams and for visions. Many of you in here, you have that sense that you're in that time. It's time. It's like you were born for this time, for such a day as this. And you're right.
Yes.
You're right. And if you'll walk with the Lord and you'll just do what he tells you to do, like we've been talking about here tonight, the God of glory will shine forth from you.
Yes, Lord.
The God of glory will shine forth from you. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Father. Lord, I thank you for healing power. Thank you for your robustia nabanda se, the glory meshia mani, te mehe fama siya to. Zenda ribaste bre meki hibe. Yeah, I see steps picking up quicker now. A pathway that's been walked, but your steps are going to pick up quicker. Quicker, quicker, quicker. You're going to walk out of some things faster. Into some other things that he has for you. Because you see, he's called us to run a race. He's called us to move at a faster pace. Not a faster pace in the natural realm, pushing and jamming and making things happen, but a spiritual pace. A spiritual pace. He's going to step the pace up. And some things that it's taken years for them to change. It's going to take months and weeks and even days, in some cases hours, and the change is going to come. So just take his hand. He knows how to help you pick up the pace. Glory to God. Thank you, Father. I thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Praise you, Jesus. Well, you got something wrong? Come on up here.
The Lord reminded me tonight, around a year ago, when I came back from the hospital and I was able to come back home to Madera, I was so excited. And the first person that the Lord put on my heart was Pastor John.
Hallelujah.
And so I called him that day just to let him know that I'm back in town from here. And so during our conversation, the Holy Spirit welled up in me with a tongue. And that had been the first time in quite a while. That's why I say when the Lord took out an old dead liver, he took out and pruned some old dead things out of Ron. And so when I came back home, I had some new things going on.
Praise God.
And the new liver. Praise God.
Yep.
But the reason why I wanted to say this tonight is God reminded me that from that tongue, when the pastor interpreted that tongue, this is what he said, and I believe that this is for all of us tonight. He said, and the gist of it, there was a lot said, but what hit the wall and stuck with me was that he said that God was placing me, God knew that Satan was going to try to take me out. I sowed the seed of hepatitis in my life when I was a young man, and the devil used it in my older age to try to take me out. And he said that God knew that he was going to do that, but it wasn't going to happen because God had a plan for me. And the plan was that he was going to set me on a plateau and I wasn't going to have to fight and I wasn't going to have to struggle. You know, I wasn't going to have to do everything that I could do to make it happen. He was going to put me there. And then he said, he told me that you saw the end time harvest. It was a big harvest. And I was running towards it. And then God turned you around the backside of me and showed that there was a bunch of people running with me. And that's you.
Amen.
Amen.
That's you.
Yes.
I was preparing us for that.
Amen.
Yeah, that's you. We're all gone. So buy your jogging shoes because we're getting ready to go for a run.
Amen. Amen. I don't think you realize how what a special group of people you are. God loves everybody the same. We know that.
Yes.
But people that have been faithful, who have stood the test of time, people that haven't quit on God. I look around this as my eyes fall on people and I know certain things about their life, like things we've been through. It seems like hell. And it has been hell coming against your life. But I'm telling you, there is a payday coming for you.
Favor and promotion.
Every prayer you pray, God's heard. And he hasn't thrown it aside. He's kept it for a moment in time. And you are going to just, like the Bible says, it says, if you go weeping, amen? If you go weeping, you'll come with seed. You'll come with your sheaves with you, rejoicing. And there's been the weep, a lot of weeping. There's been a lot of seed planting and prayer. The tears of God. David said, God keeps my tears in his bottle. God even is aware of your tears. And that seed has been planted. And we are coming now into the reaping time. And so don't let the devil disqualify you somehow, or get you to step away somehow.
Yes.
I don't care what happens in this world. This place goes nuts.
Yeah.
And it might, because I'm telling you, God's ripping the devil down from his high horse perch.
Yes.
And he's going to do that in every area of life.
Bring it.
And it could be scary.
Yeah.
It could be scary, but don't get your eyes on that, because the Lord, he told me years ago, he said, John, when you see the world go down, you're going
to
see the church go up.
Glory's going to be strong.
Arise, we're going to rise and shine. Our light has come. The glory of the Lord has risen in us.
Yes.
And you are a special group of people. I agree with Ron.
Yes.
So you just press in, see what God's saying. Because I'm telling you what, we're going to move into the fullness. Everybody say fullness.
Fullness
of what God has for us.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Thank you, Lord.
One more thing.
The Lord just showed me that all those tears.
Say it so they can hear you.
I believe the Lord just showed me that all the tears that had been wept and he bottled up and kept for us, that there's coming a day he's going to pour those back out of us like oil. Mm-hmm. Oil of the Holy Spirit. Mm-hmm. And that's where the charges arise
up. Amen. God's redoing your life.
Uh-huh. Yes.
How many of you like the movie Back to the Future? The guy went back from the future. He went back from his life back in time and cause things to happen right in the past so that his parents would meet and things would come out right in the future. That's what God is doing right now in your life. God is outside of time. He's going back and he's rearranging things. He's going to restore to you the years the enemy has ripped you off. And he's going to cause you to be the person that you would be as if the devil never attacked you.
Amen. I believe that.
He is a redeemer and he's going to redeem the times in our lives if we'll just walk with him. Amen?
Amen.
Well, praise God. I think I've said enough.